introduce our distinguished speakers of today's webinar. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Ms. Priyanka. On behalf of Science Fraternity of G.D. Goenka, East Delhi, and all other colleagues and students, I welcome Professor Neera Bhalla Sareen and Professor Verma. Professor Neera Bhalla had been associated with us now for quite some time, and ma'am has taken lots of initiatives in not only just introducing interest or infusing interest in the young children for plants, be it medicinal plants or herbal plants or any other plants. But during this pandemic time also, ma'am had made sure that the continued vision that she has, that vision prevails amongst the young children as well as the teachers. So even during this time when we are at home, ma'am has requested that on behalf of the fascination for the plants, that we call it as the Fascination of Plants Day, a very different name, ma'am, which itself is going to open up, or the secret is going to be opened up by none other than the National Coordinator, Professor Verma. So over to you, ma'am, for letting us know something more about the plants in general. And thank you, ma'am and sir, for coming over and enriching our students and teachers with this knowledge.
Pleasure, Madam Anukuma. Good morning to everybody, all the vice principal, the teachers, and the students of G.D. Goenka School. And I, as the National Coordinator of Fascinations of Plants Day, extend my warm greetings to all of you. And this is called the Fascinations of Plants Day, FOPD in short, which is a venture of European Plant Science Organization, which is EPSO in short. And this is organized all over the world every year. And many of you from this prestigious school have attended this function at the School of Life Sciences, JNU, for two consecutive years and gave very good feedback. You also got an opportunity to listen to eminent plant scientists and visit the high-tech laboratories. And you could see the kind of cutting-edge research being done in these laboratories. Now, as your madam mentioned, that this year is different, she, with the help of Ms. Priyanka, readily agreed to organize the function on a virtual mode when I requested her. And I'm really thankful to her for that, for maintaining the continuity, because all this event will go onto the portal of EPSO. Now, the main purpose of this event is to enthuse the value of plant systems in young minds and encourage them to take up plant science as a career in future. And today, you're going to listen to a very eminent plant scientist, Professor Praveen Verma. And he's going to speak on manipulation of plants for food security, as your madam mentioned, that today is the Food Security Day, from ancient past to the recent times. I'm sure you'll enjoy the talk. And after the talk, I'm sure you'll have lots of questions, which Professor Verma would be very happy to answer. And also, I'm sure he would be able to motivate many of you to take up plant science as career. I wish you good luck, and I give it back to the principal. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Neera. Professor Praveen Verma has been with JNU, that is Jawaharlal Nehru University, a very, very prestigious university of New Delhi, as the professor of science and molecular biology in the School of Life Sciences. At present, sir is the director, research and development at the university. He is also a concurrent faculty in the School of Sanskrit and Indic studies, that is Ayurveda biology. This is something very interesting, Professor Verma, associating biology with Ayurveda, and at present doing research which has connections from our ancient times. So before joining Jawaharlal Nehru University, Sir has served as a very senior scientist and group leader in National Institute of Plant Genome Research, New Delhi, for nearly 21 years. Sir has received his master's in life sciences and PhD degree in plant molecular biology from JNU only. Professor Verma has a vast experience of nearly 30 years in the field of plant biotechnology and genomics. His major research interests are plant microbe interactions and biotechnological interventions for generating disease-resistant plants. He has published more than 50 papers in reputed international journals. He has guided more than 14 to 15 PhD students till date and is very popular among students for his interesting and popular lectures. So, sir, today we've got an opportunity to listen to you and how interestingly you are going to interact with our students and bridging the gap of senior scientist and as a teacher coming to the school level. It is going to be very interesting. So I'm not going to take much of your time. Over to you, sir. And we welcome you once again in our portal.
Thank you, Principal Ma'am. This is indeed my pleasure to interact with all of you. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Audible, okay. And visible too.
Okay. So, as you mentioned about Ayurveda biology, so this is an opportunity for your students as well, because this is a new curriculum has been developed in JNU. That is from just after 11th. So many people don't have, so this is a Ayurveda biology course for, it's a 5-year integrated BS and MS course. So anybody can, join after there is a competition and you can join, this is basically most of the times when you have this type of Ayurveda biology, people talk about mostly about the treatment part. So this is more about the research part. If any of your student after finishing their 12th, they can definitely go for the Ayurveda biology in Jawaharlal Nehru University. Thank you very much. So what I am going to discuss today with this lecture is the manipulating plant for food security. So most of the time when I deliver these lectures in schools and even the colleges, the different standards are there. So, I will try to make it very, very simple, because I can see some of the students are from 7th to 9th class. So that's why I will try to make it very, very simple. But if you have any query during my lecture, you can ask later on. Definitely, I will try to ignite some of the thinking minds, young minds, and that they can take the plant science as a research in their future. So the first thing that we all know about the amazing world of plants. So this is one of everybody fascinated not about the animals, but plants are also really fascinating. So plants are basically, when we talk about the plant system, they are not very, in evolution we make a tree, and in this tree that if you see the plant, fungi and animals, they are closely together. They are all eukaryotes. And they are closely together. So this is one thing that you all have to understand, that plants are not very much different from any multicellular eukaryotes, like we call as a, probably ninth class people can understand the difference between prokaryotes and eukaryotes. So there is not much difference in the plant and animals if you think about the cellular part. So the plants are really amazing, and they are really amazing living organisms. So you can just think about this largest flower. We call it as a total root parasites. That is a Rafflesia. That is, you know, the near about the diameter of this flower is near about 1 meter. The longest living, you know, the plant. You know, no animal can live of this long. That is the bristle cone pine in the rocky mountains of USA, which is near about 5,000 years. And another is the giant sequoia. So there is a Sequoia National Park in USA where you can get, in the Mexico also, you can get, these are some of the large organisms. That is, the height of this plant is 100 meters. It's 100 meters, you can just imagine that it's just like, you know, that 10-storied building. So, or more than that. So this is one of the, you know, these are the fascinating world of the plant system. So we could not live without plants. That is very, very important. So for all the students, that we all know that plants, you know, produce most of the oxygen that we breathe. And during this last 1.5 months, you all must have heard about the importance of oxygen and why that is very, very important for all of us. So the plants produce most of the chemically stored energy we consume as a food or burn a fuel. So that you all know that most.
Sir, you've been muted. Just unmute yourself by chance. Yeah. Kindly unmute. Priyanka?
It's okay?
Yeah, right, sir.
Yes, sir.
So I will. This slide is visible? No.
Sir, everything is visible.
Okay. So, should I repeat this slide? Because you.
No, okay. It was just.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you know, the most of the storage food that which we take for as energy is from plant science, plant system, and the plant produce an amazing assortment of useful chemicals. You know, most of the Ayurveda chemicals, and even if you go for the many of the cancer treatment and the chemotherapeutic agents that comes from the plants only. The liver stage malaria, the artemisinin is also coming from the plant system, which is the for the treatment. So that we all know that we can't live without the oxygen. So initially Joseph Priestley, he recognized that animal breathing injured air. That is the experiment that he did. That in the jar he has put the mouse, which is after some time he found that is dead. But if you put a plant here along with the mouse, the plant, the animal will also survive. So this is one important thing that we can't survive or live without the oxygen. So the plants, they you all must have known in the class 9th onwards, that plant fix carbon dioxide to energy rich molecules that the animals can use as a food. So the plants convert CO2 gas into the sugars, and though through the process of the photosynthesis that we all know about this. Also, the plant can produce amazing assortment of chemicals, and many of the chemicals like vitamin E and vitamin C, you all know that caffeine from coffee, morphine, all those things are also getting produced by the plant system. So now the question is that why study plants? So this is the most important thing. So the world population is growing and growing. And this is we all is is going to be the population has already increased and become triple from 1950 to 2020. In just 70 years, it has become triple. So now world population is near about 7.5 billion individuals. So that every time it is growing. So now we have to think about, you know, 2020 to 2050. So 2050, you know, the world population or Indian population is also going to increase. And we have to feed those people and make the people, you know, secured for the, at least for the food. So if you see that, you know, the recent times the world population has gone increased in, you know, near about 70% in and is going to be increased in next 40 years of time. So this is you know, the manipulation of the hunger and this which is very, very important, and this is killing the children. So near in, this is just a data, just to show to all of you that in 2004, near about 60 million people world about died. Out of these, 10 millions of them were children under 5 years of age, of which 99% lived in a low or middle income countries. And 5 million children are under the age of five, die under the undernutrition or related issue. So this is also, you know, not only that we are we have to think about the feeding the population, but the nutrition quality as well. So that you know that you can just understand that every year, every 6 seconds in the preschool age, children are dying. Every 6 seconds, one the preschool age children is dying. So this we all have to take care. The one, you know, just example that a lack of adequate vitamin A kills 1 million of children a year. So this is every time when we have to think about the food security, we have to think about our children as well. So now the question is that what can scientists do about this? So how to increase, you know, the land is limited. It is and also shrinking because of the high level of urbanization. You know, the people are you know, taking even the field and the agricultural field for their making their houses, apartments, all those things. So you know, the land is absolutely shrinking. So for the industrialization also, the many things has happened in recent times. Some of the soil has also got contaminated where the agriculture cannot be done in those areas. So then we have to think about, you know, with all those resources, the plant scientists, you know, they can think about something else which we can, you know, which will be able to feed our children and population by 2050. So plant scientists, they can contribute to the elevation of the hunger by developing plants at the drought or stress tolerance. Drought is basically sukha parna. So that is basically the low water availability is also there, you know, for agriculture. And the different type of stress, like you all know that due to climate change, you know, that is a typical topic of the school children. Whenever there is a World Environment Day or anything, the climate change and elevation of the world temperature. So that is also going to have an effect on agriculture and growing the plants. So the drought and the stress tolerance, different types of stress, we call two different types of stress. One we call as a biotic stress, another abiotic stress. Drought, that like sukha parna, or less availability of the water, comes under the abiotic stress. Biotic stresses are, you know, different, like the attack of different fungi, bacteria, nematodes, viruses, many other things comes under the biotic stress. So we require the less fertilizer or water. Why? I will just show you that why these are important for all of us. That the requirement of fertilizer or less water is also very, very important. Now our Prime Minister has also started one campaign. More crop per drop. So that is the the slogan that he has given. So that we all have to start in this manner, thinking in this manner, and the plants should be resistant to various pathogens that I have told you about. Plants are also vulnerable to various type of diseases, and they should also more nutritious. So this all we have to understand, and how we can develop the all these things in the future. So the drought stress, if you see that it's basically compounded by increasing global temperature. And in one of the study of the climate change, the world temperature in 2050 is going to be increased from 3 degrees to 5 degrees. So this is quite a huge if you compare to all these things. Like you all are now sitting sometimes in this even the temperature goes up to 45, you all feel very, very stressed and very, very difficult to survive. You all move towards the cooler, AC and fan. But think about what will happen if it is going to increase 5 degrees, that is 50 degrees. So it is, it's going to be very, very difficult for all of us. So, the plant scientists, that they can do, they can increase the drought tolerance by using different type of genes. So I think by ninth class onwards, you must be knowing something about the genes and other that some factors are there which are basically inherited. That means goes from the parents to offspring. They are important for the different characters. So we, as a plant scientist or plant molecule biologist, we do change those genes. And how we change, and after changing, suppose this is some of the plant which is well watered. If you give the 10 days of the drought stress, 20 days of drought stress, all of them are dying. But if we change those things, if you rewater those plants, the plants which are drought resistant plant will be surviving. But the wild type, that means the natural plants, they will not survive. So this is the how we can develop certain plants for survival in those elevated the temperature conditions. So another point is that we can, as a plant scientist, we can increase the length of the roots. So increase more the length of the root, you can definitely go for the more drought tolerant plants, because they will have the water, they can draw the water from a very very long distance in the soil. So another point is the fertilizer. The fertilizers are basically, so we use potassium, phosphate, nitrogen, and many other nutrients. Most of the synthesis of the nitrogen fertilizers is a huge amount of energy is being used. And another point is that if you can discuss with your parents that if you go to the areas where small ponds are there, now most of the ponds are turning green in color. That is because of the the high level of algal growth, and that is coming because of the indiscriminate use of the fertilizers. The fertilizer, after if you put in the field, the rain comes and the fertilizer will leach out. It will go to the different ponds, even the various part of the sea, and it will start. The many algal blooms will start in all these areas. So this is one thing that we all have to understand, that the indiscriminate use of the fertilizer should not be there. But you know, that as a plant scientist, we can, you know, even for the less, we can make the plants in such a way that, you know, even for the less amount of fertilizer is being used in the field, they can survive in a better manner, or they can give a very good yield. So this is how, you know, the plant scientists, you know, that they talk about. Even the plant nutrient uptake, which they can improve by the different type of techniques. The another point is that, you know, the many of the fungal pathogen that I just want to make you people you know, understand all these things. Like, many pathogens are really threatening to the agriculture. One of the most important pathogen is the Phytophthora infestans, which actually cause a potato late blight disease. I do have one slide. I will just show you. And another is the Puccinia graminis tritici. So this is basically causes a rust disease. So both of them are now again becoming a threat of the potato and the wheat. This is actually this actually infect potato. This infect the wheat. So the late blight of potato is basically, you can just imagine the one thing that you all must have heard about the First World War and Second World War. The people who have, you know, it has started near about 1840. This is called Great Irish Famine. So this is this has started long back in near about Ireland and adjacent areas, and near about 1 million of people died because of their disease in the plants. So now you can just imagine, now you all are thinking about the COVID pandemic. This was also one of the pandemic which has happened with the plants and has affected. So if you compare with the First World War and Second World War, how many people have died? This was much more than the people died in the First World War and Second World War. People also got displaced. If you go to Ireland, I visited, you know, the Ireland once, and from the airport itself, you will see lots of sculptures of, you know, dying people and other this type of people for this disease of the plants. So now that's why I'm telling you that not only the animal, you know, the pathology and everything that we have to understand, we have to understand all these things for our survival. So another thing is that we can, how you can do. There is a thing we call the identification of resistance genes. So this basically gives a immunity to the plants. So the geneticist, they identify all these things, and they can, you know, make the plants the resistant to the particular disease. This is one of the diseases, another disease which is going to be very, very important for the mankind and also for the India. That is called UG99. It has started in year 99 in Uganda. And the important thing is that, you know, most of the world wheat, you all know that India, we also eat rice, but most of the people eat wheat. You know, aata khate hai zyada log. So, but that is the important thing is that this is going to, none of the natural varieties of the wheat is resistant to this Uganda 99. So this is also one of the examples. So this is African map, and this is India's map, and this has started somewhere here in Uganda, and it is because of some part of the dry part of the area of the Middle East region, the spores are not going to have reached to the area which is wheat growing area of India. Otherwise, this is going to be pandemic. and it's very difficult for everybody to survive if this particular disease will come to India. So now agriculture scientists are taking very much care of that this disease will not come. And some of the varieties that people have already found and isolated the characters by which it is transferring the resistance of this particular variety. So this is one thing that I just wanted to tell all of you. Another point is that the
excuse me, sir, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
I'm feeling very happy and excited that students have lots of questions in mind and you have actually enthused students in asking questions. So can we have a little break and answer the questions to the students?
No problem.
Priyanka ma'am, will you moderate and read out the questions that the students have asked?
Yes, ma'am. So, sir, as you have illuminated our students' minds as well as ours, so the first question here, it is from Zehra Abbas. Zehra, would you please unmute yourself and switch on your video and please ask, sir, your question?
Yes, ma'am. Good morning, sir. It was really nice listening to what you had to say. So actually, I wanted to ask that as human activities are increasing day by day, the number of plants are really reducing. Being a scientist, what measures can you take? So, sir, can you please tell how can we help in this, being a responsible citizen?
See, you are talking about the different plants. I can tell you, on 5th, I have given one lecture on World Environment Day as well. So there, I have given emphasis on there are, near about 236 varieties of the plants in India. They are, treated as a endangered in India. And critically endangered are near about 9 plants. So we all have to think about these things, like we many of the lands and everything is getting shrink due to the indiscriminate the development, the unmined development in all these things. So we have to we have to think about the forestry, think about the land, and the rules or laws should be made in such a way that the forest cover, whatever we do have in our country, that should not get affected. So and for us also, like I know many of the students, even I can tell all of you that you can also start at least per week you start planting at least one plant in your vicinity. So that will also going to help, because urban life is also going to be affected in this particular things. So we all have to think about this very good question that you have raised in this particular. Thank you
so much, sir.
Thank you, sir. I hope, Zehra, your question has been answered well by sir. Sir, next question we have is by Vanshika Daga. Vanshika, please unmute yourself and switch on your video and ask your question.
Ma'am, actually, I typed it by mistake. It was not a
question.
Okay. No worries, Vanshika. You can ask your question.
Ma'am, I'm not having a question for now. I'll be asking later.
Okay, you'll be asking later. Fine. Vasu Agarwal?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, please.
Good morning, sir. Sir, I wanted to ask that, that gene editing, can it be reversed for the plants that have been already infected before the editing?
What you have asked? You are in which class?
Sir, 10th class.
Excellent. You know, there is one thing that you talked about the gene editing. This is good. And I do have some slides. I will talk about.
Okay, sir.
So he's probably going to be the next research scientist.
Good. Great. And I'm really, you know, overwhelmed with this question.
Yes, sir. Next, we have Tishita Tucker. Can you please unmute yourself?
Yes, ma'am. Good morning, sir.
Sir is going to answer his question. So he's just fixing
up. No, I do have one slide, for gene editing. Yeah. We will, discuss. You know,
okay.
So in between, I have stocks. So it's all right.
Good morning, sir. Sir, actually, I wanted to ask, we are at this stage where we want to save trees and also we are cutting them for many purposes. So how can we balance the situation?
It's a general phenomena that if you cut one tree, you have to plant at least five. So that, we can do. You know, last year, near about, 25 lakhs, you all are in... 25 lakhs, 25 crore. The plant has been, planted in one day and throughout India. So the such type of things that also we can start. The even the social forestry and other thing that should be, So there are two parts. One part is the urban part. Another part is the rural part. So both parts should be, important. Try to plant those things which are native to those areas. If you are suppose if you are planting some you must have seen if you have taken any railway journey, you must have seen eucalyptus plant. Eucalyptus plant is not native to India. It's from from Australia. So those plants are basically destroying the nearby vegetation also. So try to plant those plants which are native to India, like neem, like peepal, all those things that you all should, try to plant.
Thank you, sir. Sir, one more question before you can again start. That is by Sudhanshu Khanna of class 10th.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
So I have a simple question that as you just told about that the population is increasing rapidly and the soil is degrading day by day. So sir, can hydroponic be the new future which requires this water and give decent amount of crops?
See, hydroponics are, nowadays, the people are making all these hydroponics. Even I have seen, some of the engineering students, they are devising, making some device which we can use in the balcony. And so this one of the company that I know, which we have funded by Department of Biotechnology, Government of India, that is in doing very good work in Bangalore. So this is going to be a very good future, but the cultivation like the wheat and rice, which we take in a large quantity, that is very difficult to go for the hydroponic. Only those plants like the salad for some of the vegetables, all those things that we can do in the hydroponic. Many countries are doing such type of hydroponic. Even Japan is very much in this particular thing. Hydroponic is going to be a future for the urban, the growth of the agriculture.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir. Sir, we think that we can continue wearing our thinking caps.
Yeah, last in the end, I will.
Yeah, in the end, sir.
Time.
Thank you, sir.
We can. So not only the increase the yield, you have to increase the different the nutrition quality of the plants. So nutrition quality of the plants is very very important. Like we all know that. Anemia is one of the most important thing in all third world countries or developing countries. So this is the mostly young children are there. You can just see that Africa, even Indian continent, they are having the anemia in the young children. So those things like high, the iron content, if you can increase in the plants, that will help. Similarly, the vitamin A deficiency is also very important that I have already told. If we can develop some sort of plant which will have a vitamin, which can take off the vitamin A deficiency. I do have a slide. We will discuss about this vitamin A deficiency and all these things. So the ultimately that we have to, you know, the in the practice, we have to fortify foods with vitamins, folate, that is vitamin B and vitamin A, and iron, zinc, iodine. They are with, you know, there are two parts of nutrition. One is the macronutrition and another is micronutrition. So some of the micronutrition or micronutrients are very, very important for the children's growth. They are also, we can, you know, introduce into the plants. How? This we will talk about. So this is, we can do by using the genetically modified plants or genetically biofortified foods that we can develop by the iron-rich rice. This is one of the tomato that people have developed, which is having the high antioxidant content, that is vitamin B. This is golden rice. I do have another slide of this golden rice, where the vitamin A is increased. And this is one of the most important thing. If you take this golden rice, you can have the vitamin A deficiency you can talk about. And even the iron-rich rice, that is also going to very important for the growth of the children. So the plants they can provide more provide us more than the food. That is, the plants are the source of the novel therapeutic drugs. I will discuss about this point. They can provide better fibers for paper and fabric. As you all know, that whatever the paper that you are using is a plant product. Are the resources of bio-renewable products and provide renewable energy sources. So all these things are, I will discuss in one or two slides. So that's one thing that we call, I know that you all are now hearing about the vaccination programs of COVID-19. So COVID-19 is usually, the people are not taking the vaccine just because of, the many things. So now there's a concept we call as a plantibodies. That means you are making antibody in the plants. Suppose I am taking expressing the plants, making the enriched with that particular COVID-19 in the banana. And if you take the banana, you will become, resistant. This is a concept. Few things has already developed, but definitely the research is going on in all these things. Definitely, therefore, the COVID-19 in this type of things has not got developed yet. But definitely it is going to be future of the people, where you can develop those plantibodies into the edible fruits, and then you can eat those things and you can be immunized. Another thing is that you all know that the petroleum is not a renewable source, and the petroleum products are getting decreased. So every country, I think 2-3 years back I visited Sweden, and I found that most of the Sweden is the government buses, they are actually being run on biofuel. So this is also one of the important part of the plants, that how we can enhance or make the plants which can give more biofuel in the forms of ethanol. So that is also going to be many plants like Jatropha and other plants are getting in this particular things. Another thing is that this is also one of the things that you all should be excited about, that from the plant we can express or we can produce plastics. So these plastics will be biodegradable. So these are also on the way that people are making such type of things, which is bio-renewable and biodegradable in source. So these are some of the examples how we can, So next 5 minutes, I am going to finish it with some of the things which you all have asked about how to manipulate the plants. The plants are being modified for the thousands of years. Near about 10,000 years ago, so the people have started, the many we call it as a selection breeding. Near about the 10,000 years ago, the plants are major crops are domesticated. You all must have heard in your history classes that you know the people are getting aggregated to a particular point. Mainly all of the civilization has developed near the river basin. And because of the agriculture, they have to stay at a particular place because they have to sow the seed and then harvest the seeds. So all these things are, you know, happening happened during those period and this human civilization. So most of the human civilization, I'm just skipping this slide, that there are some records of the rice, bean, and has developed in Indian subcontinent near about 8,500 years ago. So how this happens? Basically, that suppose if this is a corn, and if you have, you know, there's so many varieties of the corn, this one is the most suitable. So you take the seed of this, grow it to another generation, and by different generation, you again select. So this we call as a selection breeding, by which you can develop a new variety of the plant, which is more yielding to the natural varieties. So this is the one thing that I can just give you one of the example, like maize. 7,000 years ago, it was very small, just like 1 rupee coin. And you know, now it has become, you know, 500 years ago, now it's bigger, but now it has become much more bigger. So this is, you know, the archaeological sites in the Mexico, what people have found. And these things have, people have, you know, done by this selection breeding. I mean the selecting the better plant, suitable plant for the next generation. So such type of things that you know started long back, and this is the 500 years back, and now it is being developed for the new things. I'm just skipping all these things. Like earlier, the plants were having lots of branches and very small seed size, and the seeds were also covered. But if you see, this is 1 rupee coin, this is 1 rupee coin. So you can just compare both the things. Now this is less, having less branch, but having, you know, the more number of seeds, the fruit size is also, you know, larger in case. Another we called as a hybrid things. Like when you cross these plants A and B, these are two parents, either B to A or A to B. This is what we called as a hybrid vigor, which you can get, you know, better seeds if you are crossing both the things. This crossing has actually started long back our green revolution in Indian subcontinent. This green revolution that one of the scientists is known as Norman Borlaug, and he was basically a pathologist from the Mexico, and he is known as the father of a green revolution in India. If you talk to your parents or even grandparents of, the neighbors do have some older people, you can ask those era when the people our prime minister was Lal Bahadur Shastri, and he has asked at least fast one day in a week, because the grains were very less. Now we do have at least three. For 3 years, if you don't grow even a single plant in the field, we do have enough things stored in our stores. So this has happened because of those era, 1975 to 1985. So those era, they buy this particular thing. And you must have heard about the name of Professor M.S. Swaminathan. He was the person also along with this. And he has got Nobel Prize for this particular work. He has not got the Nobel Prize for science. He has got Nobel Prize for peace, because if you have a filled stomach, you will not fight. So that's why people have this is one of the things that people started. So you can just see that the India and Pakistan. At that time, the grain was very less, but because of the green revolution and these breeding techniques, we are crossing with one plant which is native and another plant which is having a very good yield quality, that has become very nice, you know, that the yield, and it is actually helping us. So how this is happening, because I'm just giving you one example. Suppose there is an elite tomato which is growing right now. Another is a poor tomato which is disease resistant. So you have to cross these plants, and you have to grow for, you know, the cross these plants for near about 7 to 10 generation. And after 7 to 10 generation, you will get some of the plants which will have a disease resistant character, and that you can use for the field. And this has actually, this was the major things in the for the Green Revolution, where the dwarf rice or dwarf wheat variety was crossed with the Indian varieties, and it was the increase of yield was near about 2 to 3 times from the earlier varieties. So I'm just skipping all these things. This is 7 to 8 generation that you have to do. So the genetic modified crops, basically that you can do nowadays very easily by using the, you know, the, suppose, you know, the breeding has a problem that it, you can cross only two variety, like one wheat with another wheat, one maize with another maize. But by genetic engineering, you can, you know, from the a plant, which is, it's a wheat plant, which is Arabidopsis thaliana, which is having the disease resistant character. And you take the gene and transfer to elite tomato, that is basically a gene or recombinant DNA technology that you can do. So this type of things that you have to understand, that the source of gene that you have to isolate, manipulate in the laboratory, your test tube, we are doing in our laboratory, and then transfer, make everything, and then transfer to other plant, and the plant will become, you know, the resistant. So this type of things are, you know, they're going to for the advanced studies and very, very fascinating to all of us. So this I'm also skipping. Another example is the, it's a famous example of BT toxin, where, you know, the BT is basically, it's a gene from the bacteria, and it is being transferred to the plant system, and the plant will become, you know, resistant to the, that particular insect. So this is actually, it's having a toxin, which is protoxin, and when insect, some variety of insect, which is called Nepeterian insect, and that they, if they eat, it will become, you know, toxin. From the protoxin to it will become toxin, and the insect will die. So this is, I'm skipping again. So another example of GM has also revolutionized many places in Africa. So this is one of the example where, you know, the most of the African, you know, even Congo, Africa, and many other countries near about Congo, Nigeria, many people are very, very poor. And their major livelihood was the banana cultivation. And it was susceptible to one of the bacterial diseases. Now they have made the resistant things. And one of the Indian scientists, you know, Dr. Lina is involved in this particular things, and actually it had changed the Congo and many other countries. So adjacent countries, like I talked about the golden rice, which is also important, the beta carotene that you can engineer, that in the maize you can engineer, in cassava you can engineer, in cauliflower, all those things that you can do. Another point which Vasu Agarwal has asked about the genome engineering, which is a new technique which has come very recently, and very recently it has found that, you know, we can do precise genome engineering, which will not be treated as a GM crop. And first you have to identify the gene which is important, or the DNA portion of the DNA which is important for the that particular character, and do the precise engineering. You don't have to change entire plant. You don't have to cross anything. The precise engineering that you can do, definitely, that this is called as genome editing or genome engineering. So this, the typical is called as a CRISPR-Cas, which is very important. And 3 years back, the Nobel Prize has also been given on this particular CRISPR-Cas technology. This is being going to be a future of the plant genetic engineering. So now there's a we all have to think about the second green revolution. The second green revolution can come only with GM crops and this genome editing technology. And that we have to understand that this is a need of the hour, because we have to feed our the increasing population. And this is possible with only with gene crop and molecular breeding and genome editing technologies. And this will give the food security to for all in future. Thank you very much. Now you can, Vasu, if you have any question, now you can ask.
Yes, thank you, sir. You have certainly enhanced our curiosity, and I'll not take much time and we'll go with question answer session. Basu, can you please unmute now?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir, thank you very much, first of all. Sir, I had one doubt. So that the plants which are not edited, but they have already been diseased. So, sir, can we turn them into healthy plants back?
Definitely. Now, nowadays, we all are, even my laboratory is working on susceptibility genes. There are two parts. One we call as a resistant, and another is susceptibility. So there is one thing we call as a mutation. So if you buy this, the genome engineering technique, if you can mutate those susceptibility genes, the plant will become resistant. So this type of technology is being used. Last 3-4 years, this is definitely is going to be, many paper and many people have gone through all these things and developed such type of plants.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Next, we have Diva Singh Chabra, 7th B. Can you please unmute yourself and switch on your video? Diva Singh. Yes, Divas, you are you're audible. You can ask your question.
Ma'am, I wanted to ask that will we be vaccinated after eating the particular fruit?
It's a good question. If you think about the polio vaccination you take in your oral vaccination, that is an oral vaccination. So such type of vaccination people can do. Even for the Bharat Biotech nowadays, they are going to do with the nasal vaccination. Nasal vaccination for COVID-19. So those things that, definitely for oral vaccination things, polio vaccination and other things, similar things that can be developed as a plant antibodies and that can be used. It's a good question. No, actually, all these, it's a good question. All these things, whenever you are expressing, in a very small quantity. Even with the vaccine, you are taking just, the few drops, polio drops, one drop you are taking in your mouth. So similar time, that will not change. So basically, say all those antigens are basically protein, and it is not going to, change the taste as well.
Okay, sir. Next, we have Ambar Kaushik, 12th A. Ambar, please unmute yourself and switch on your video.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, as most of the people are affected by COVID-19, what would be the best tool for this situation to measure food security in rural areas?
See, COVID-19, you are asking about COVID-19 and food security. Food, most of the times, the food security if you're thinking is in a larger perspective, then the food security things come. This is basically, it's an issue of the delivering your food to the villages and other things. That is basically local type of problems. That can be done by the administrative betterment of all these things. last few months or even the first the wave, that we all have, you know, experienced this type of things when people started migrating towards their villages and having the food problems. So the foods were are there in our, you know, stores and you know, the large stores there that we do have. It was a problem of distribution. So the distribution chain should be, you know, done in a better manner so that people cannot be experience this type of you know, problem in future.
Thank you, sir.
We have with us Ms. Ragini Rastan, our biology teacher. So she okay. would also like to ask question.
Great. Yeah.
Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon. Thank you so much for such an informative session. Sir, so I wanted to ask that after seeing the effects of BT cotton or the result of BT cotton and BT brinjal after nearly 2 decades, shouldn't we learn about the creation of super weeds or super bugs or horizontal gene transfer? Shouldn't we be bothered about it?
I usually deliver a lecture on this, you know, so it will take 1 hour to convince you. But usually, you know, for all this, whenever you are talking about BT and GM crops, GM crops are not all about the BT toxin, you know. So those things are, you know, the many GM crops are, you know, suppose I'm taking a gene from a plant system and, you know, manipulating a little bit and again transferring to the plants, that is also going to be, you know, a GM crop, and that is not going to have much effect on the environment. If you talk about the horizontal gene transfer, there are many aspects and many, you know, the nowadays, you know, the similar way that people are talking about, you know, my sister has recently, you know, she stays in somewhere in Uttar Pradesh. She has sent a WhatsApp message that after 2 years, the taking of the vaccine, you will all be going to die. So this type of message, you know, this is something is, you know, the jitne log kaam karte hain usse zyada bhram phailate hain. So this is happening in India for the GM crops as well. There is nothing called. There are so many experimental things are there. People have talked about even the horizontal gene transfer into, you know, the many of the butterflies. Even all those things that people have talked about. Usually, this is specific to a very, very important and only one family of larva, not to any others. The larva will have a protease in their gut. It will not any other insect will have that particular protease in their gut. It will never become, you know, the protoxin to toxin. So this has, you know, many experiment has people have done. Many people of the important thing is that the people are more vocal. Those people who are actually making this type of myths. So there nothing called all these things in all these things. BT brinjal and other things is one example. If you, I can tell you that one, if you visit to Gujarat, Maharashtra and Andhra Pradesh, near about 90% of cotton is now being growing is the BT cotton. So people, you know, think about, you know, some person will come, you know, that just for joke, you know, they don't take this. That some people will come, meri bakri jo hai, wo usne wo BT cotton khaya aur wo mar gayi. Ho sakta hai wo raat mein khud hi mar ke kha gaya ho, lekin wo kahega ki this is not the case. We all have to understand in a larger perspective. Being a scientist, I cannot say that, you know, by just taking BT, you know, drinking the pesticides and many farmers in the Andhra Pradesh and Maharashtra and Gujarat, they are committing suicide. It's better to grow BT. That is my case.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, with your permission, can we take few more questions?
Yeah, yeah, no problem. I am here.
Yeah. So, Rishang Kalra, please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Sir, I wanted to ask that we know that fertilizers are good for the crop yield, But on the other hand, the excess use of fertilizers pollute the soil as well, and soil and water as well. So, sir, we should use natural fertilizers, manures, or how can this situation be balanced?
Definitely. You know, people are going towards this organic farming. And even one state of our country, like Sikkim, has become the first organic state. Now, so that we all are moving towards. And I can tell you that another point is that, you know, these artificial fertilizer or chemical fertilizer, they have, you know, done a tremendous job during the Green Revolution, first Green Revolution. But now what happens? Like, people are going to the market, the farmers are going to the market, and they don't ask, you know, they ask, aaj kal kya chal raha hai, kaun sa ye chal raha hai, and they take those, you know, the fertilizer. Suppose if you don't require that particular, you know, the chemical, that mainly the NPK, that is we call nitrogen, phosphorus, and sulfur. So potassium. So all these things are, you know, basically whatever you are requiring. That's why Prime Minister has started long back a new scheme, that is the soil health scheme. You get it analyzed. You know, whatever, you know, the things are there, you know, that and whatever the amount is required, then only you take. The similar thing is, you know, since you have asked this question, that indiscriminate use of the pesticides and insecticides has also, you know, gone for all these things. The Green Revolution has come with the pesticides and insecticides. And these are also going to, you know, havoc all these, our environment. I can tell you, just, you know, being a student, you just search cancer train, you know, in just Google it. And you will find lots of, you know, the information. Basically, the Green Revolution, you know, that it has started mostly in Punjab and Haryana. And they indiscriminately, they are using, even though you require, you know, very small quantity of those pesticide and insecticide, people are spraying. They go to the market, ask the person, he will see that, where is my margin? You know, he will say, nahin, nahin, yehi wala aap leke chale jao. Wahan par aapko 2 ppm aapko use karna ho, woh keh dega 10 ppm use karna ho, you are using. So in the cancer train, there it train comes from Bhatinda to no long back. Now they have now cancer hospital in Bhatinda. Earlier it was not there in Bhatinda. So they will go to Bikaner. So this is called as a cancer train because it actually starts in 10 o'clock in the night and reach by 4:30 or 5 o'clock in the Bikaner. And entire train was full of cancer patients. And this is only because of this, you know, definitely we have to go for that. So, you know, this, all your young minds should, you know, think about all these things in for the, you know, better future, because, you know, that cancer cases are increasing just like that. And because of all these, you know, the use of the pesticide, insecticides, all those are very, very important.
Thank you, sir. Now we have Salvia Verma of 9th B.
Okay. Yes, Salvia.
Good afternoon, sir. I wanted to ask just a little query I have. Earlier in the session, you said that animal breathing can injure air. I didn't understand that how... you said that animal breathing can injure air.
Injure air? I have not told. I have told that, you know, animal breathing... Okay, go for the full question. Okay. Go for the full question. You are unmute.
Sir, I wanted to ask that earlier in the session, you said that animal breathing can injure air. So, I didn't understand how can animal breathing injure air. You gave an example of mouse.
Oh, that is the typical example. You know, it's not that, you know, the, you are taking oxygen and you know, exhaling the carbon dioxide. So what will happen after some times, the if that is in a confined, you know, jar or anything, the all oxygen will get exhausted and then the animal will die. But if you take a plant along with the animal, what will happen? It will inhale, it will do photosynthesis, and after in the green plants, they actually release oxygen. So that oxygen will be utilized by the animal and animal will survive.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you.
Next question is by Tanvi Kabra, class 10C.
Yes, sir. Sir, I wanted to ask that like these days, online and technology has a great impact on everything we do. So what is the contribution of technology in advancement of plant science?
For information technology? No.
The technology and online things, these all.
Yeah, see what I can give you the answer in this way, that world, because of this the information and other things, and the now we do have living in the era of information technology, where the entire world has become shrinked to a very small area. So the most of the plant scientists and everybody is now being connected. They are getting the feedback from each other. We do have whenever we do have a research, we go for the publication. We call it as a publication in the international journals, so that people can access in their computer. And then they can design their experiments. Such type of things has that is very important. So I think this will answer your question. If Neera ma'am can answer this, this is very. She I can tell you she was my teacher also. She taught me. So
yes, sir. Next we have Shashwat Goyal, please unmute and ask your question.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, I wanted to ask that how that can gene alteration cause ecological imbalances? Because as we have observed in humans, gene alteration causes many times a deficiency to toxicity to many things.
So I have given one example. There are some myths and apprehension about the BT toxin I have just talked about. There are myths about this manipulation of the genome or manipulation of disease in the plants. If I can give you just one share, I'll just give you the example that even for the crossing or even the selection. From the 10,000 years, we have manipulated our genes, tremendously. So, the entire genome has got manipulated. So in the plants, actually, we look for the better yield, better quality, better survival, quality. So those things that we go for the selection. This is not going to, that's why I have given you the historical perspectives that last 10,000 years, we have definitely manipulated our plants. It's not that recently we are trying to manipulate the plants by the quicker techniques, but those techniques were very long. I told you that earlier the crossing and the integration of a gene takes 7 to 10 generations. Now by new techniques you can go for 2 to 3 generations. So this type of things has enhanced even the breeding, as well as, so all those things, like the initial things, if you remember one of my slides where I talked about the elite variety, another is wild variety. So elite variety, we don't want to change. So what we do is that at the time of breeding or any genetic modification, we keep on breeding with one of the mother or one of the parent, we call it as a back crossing. So if one of the mother should be the your elite variety, so that it will not get changed that much. So entire the genome should be remaining just like elite variety, but only one or few characters which is important for the disease resistant or you know, drought tolerance or any type of tolerance. So that will be getting you know, added to that.
Thank you, sir.
After Shashwat, it's Kriti Gupta. Kriti, would you please unmute?
Hello, sir.
Hello.
So my question is that there has been an increase in the use of biotechnology, transgenesis, and artificial hybridization. So the crops which are produced by these processes, are they the same level of safe for the environment which were the crops developed using traditional breeding practices?
It's absolutely safe. It's absolutely safe. You all know that, you know, the USA has a maximum, you know, the stringent law for the food and the consumer protections. And there, you know, many crops, you know, that now they have they are being, you know, for the eating also. People are using the transgenic tomato, transgenic, many of the crops that people are using. Banana is what people are using. It is not having any effect. It is just like I was talking about, that people are talking about that taking the COVID vaccine, you are all going to die. That means first, you know, the entire USA will going to die because they have taken maximum number of vaccination. So it's something, you know, people do have their mind. It's not true. Transgenics are safe.
I hope, Kriti, your doubt and query is solved by sir. Sir, a few more questions. Yeah. I know we have extended her time.
You can come.
Kashvi, no, it's Parth Garg, class 9.
Yes, good Parth, afternoon, please, sir.
Please switch on your video, Parth.
Okay. Good afternoon, sir. I wanted to ask that, like, you told there were diseases of plants. So, like, was there any impact on human life also by that? And, like, how were the things tackled at that time?
It's a very good question. Like, many of the diseases of the plants, they don't actually come to the human being. Most of the diseases. I mean, the only few examples are there. Like, Phytophthora, you know, they called as a one... we call it as oomycetes. People have found that, you know, the oomycetes of some of the oomycetes, which actually cause this red black potato, that effect infect you know the some of the fish and some of the frogs. Some of the frog population has also been getting, you know, diminished because of that. So all those things that basically you are asking about, that the plant disease to human, actually had it been, you know, we all have not got survived. So, you know, usually they don't, you know, cross. And most of the diseases, they don't. But, you know, there are some of the diseases, like you must have heard about black fungus or, you know, mycobacteriosis in this COVID time. That actually also, you know, the it's basically a saprophytic fungus. So it's not with the living plants, but you know, the plants which are decaying, there also you can find such type of black fungus. It is there, it's not a new fungus. So that, such type of things are there in the system, but hardly, you know, the plant pathogen are getting, you know, they are getting infected to the animal system also, very hardly.
Thank you, sir. Next, we have Kashvi Jain of class 10th A. Kashvi, please unmute yourself.
Good afternoon, sir. So, sir, there has been a debate on the consumption of transgenic food or products. So, today, with the commercialization of few plant varieties, what can we expect future about transgenic food?
See, I've told you two things. One thing is that, you know, now the breeding and everything has got saturated. And because, you know, in the breeding, you have to cross from one variety to other variety of the same type. But in the transgenic plant, you can, you know, from one plant, suppose I do have a gene from a tobacco or any other plant. I can transfer to the wheat or rice. So that is, you know, the advantage that has been made. So one thing is that, you know, if you want to feed the or go for the second green revolution, you have to have, you know, depend upon all these things. Sooner or later, it is going to, you know, be in picture. Only, you know, the hurdle in Indian condition is that, you know, that what I found that, you know, that I also been on the TV debates sometimes. And what I found that we scientists are, you know, not much more vocal. We also, you know, the most of the people who are actually against the, all these things, they are, you know, not, they are much more vocal. They come to the television, they come to the WhatsApp group, they come to all those things. Like the COVID, you know, the vaccination, the rumor has started with that, you know, the one Nobel laureate has, you know, that told that people are going to die in 2 years. No Nobel laureate has told, please. So what this type of things are, you know, we, you know, now this is an opportunity and the challenge to all scientists like me, that we all have to come to the public platform, try to convince the people that this is not happening. You know, see, this is also happening. Nobody is listening to the AIIMS director. People are listening to their WhatsApp university. No, this is happening, you know. So that's why, you know, this is the problem, but sooner or later it is going to happen. So what we are called as a, you know, the transgenics I talked about, what about cisgenics? You know, like suppose I do have a gene from the apple, I'm manipulating and transferring to the apple itself. So what is the problem? So that's why, you know, the sooner or later it is going to happen. In 2018, it was almost done. The first in the crop plants from the Delhi University South Campus by Professor Deepak Pintel, and it was almost done. You know, 2018, that it is going to be, you know, recognized by the authorities. There are so many things, but now still it is in the problem. But I can tell you one good example. That if you think about Bangladesh have now near about 67 varieties of brinjal is growing as a BT brinjal. And somehow those brinjals has getting transported to the in India. Some places, you know, last month itself in Bengal and Bihar, the report has come that somehow people have taken those plants and they are growing. They are very much happy. So if you will not able to, you know, tackle all these things by law, people are going to take like this. You must have, you know, you must have realized that now you people are taking, you know, the papaya, which is red in color. You know, how it has come to India? Usually papaya is in a deep orange, you know, in color. But, you know, very deep red in color. This is all transgenic. How it has reached, we all are eating. Nothing has happened. So how it has reached, we don't know. Many people, you know, they, because most of the transgenic plants, they actually being, you know, targeted by these multinational companies. So people who are against the multinational companies, they are actually opposing those transgenic plants. But what about the people like us who are working in a research institute, a government research institute or university? We are doing, like Deepak Pintel is doing, we should recognize those things.
Thank you, sir. I can recall when, you know, as a teacher, student had asked the teacher, ma'am, rose is always red, tomatoes are also always red. But now, gone are those days, if we bring science into art or science into the imagination of the general public, tomatoes can no longer be red. Brinjal can be white and purple too. Maybe a day will come that lady fingers also will have a different color. So the beauty of science, the beauty of research is something that is going to probably bring home science into everyone's life. And indirectly, COVID has also brought science into everyone's life. People have started appreciating biology and everything related to biology. It used to be considered as a boring subject, but now everyone knows how fascinating it is and how important it is for everyone's survival. So we have taken a lot of time, sir, and you have answered all the questions in such a beautiful manner that I know there are lots of questions still left, and this is going to be the beginning. Our students have been, you know, they have given some calls to certain teachers indicating that if time permits, we can go to Professor Praveen Verma's lab and see how the work goes on over there. So, sir.
Now we, if COVID permits.
Yes, sir. If COVID permits.
Definitely.
But if you are in the lab, sir, then if you can take a tour of the lab and show to our students certain experiments that have been done, and you know, that will directly put more curiosity in the young minds. And maybe, sir, who knows, that you will be the guide professor to one of our students. Thank you, sir. And thank you, Professor Neera. Would you like to conclude the session?
I must thank Professor Verma. He has given an excellent talk. And as they say, it's like a cycle. I think I was the one who introduced genetic manipulation of plants course, you know, way back in 90s when he was a student. And now I'm learning so much from him. So this is really something very appreciable. And he's answered all the questions beautifully, and I have learned a lot from him. So I must congratulate him for doing such a great job. As regards visiting his lab, of course, he's the best person to answer. But right now, I think under lockdown conditions, very few people, the students who have to finish their thesis, only some of those students are allowed. So safety first. So whenever the conditions are good, I'm sure he would be happy to, you know, sort of give you all a tour of the facilities that are existing and all that. So all that is possible. So thank you very much for giving us an opportunity. And we would very much appreciate, you know, a write-up of the event, like how many students attended and, you know, like question answer sessions were there, et cetera, so that we can upload it on the FOPD site. And that'll be excellent. And thanks a lot, Praveen, for everything.
Thank you. Thank you. And I know, being a director of R&D, we are going to organize an open day in Jawaharlal Nehru University. And there we are going to, you know, allow the students, the school students, to the laboratory and show some experiment there also. So that also we are going to soon, we are going to announce after the pandemic. Maybe, you know, I'm also planning with some online this type of experiments, where we can, you know, people can join us. Thank you.
I was looking forward for the online experiments to begin with, and we will not, you know, trouble you for having the students and considering the safety of that. But let's begin with online experiments, sir, if you are visiting them. Okay. Thank you so much again. And thank you, Professor Neera. Thank you.
You're welcome. Let's give a hearty vote of thanks, clapping. Thank you. This is a good session. Thank you very much. Bye.
Thank you. Thank you.
Bye, Priyanka.